This is the Slaughter Cattle Division meeting at the 1981 National Farmers Convention at Indianapolis, Indiana. And now, here's Andy Neusling, Director of the Slaughter Cattle Division.
On behalf of the Slaughter Cattle Division staff, I'd like to welcome all of you to our 1981 National Convention. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to be here, and I've heard that saying, I guess, in every meeting I've attended, but I have a special reason for my pleasures being here, because this is my first national convention since 1972. Some of you may have remembered me in this very same department in 1969 to 1972. I returned a year ago last April, and I found a department that you could call just a little dream back in the early days of the organization. And by that, I mean I found a department that could market your production in a collective bargaining system any way you, as cattle producers, wanted to market them. Back in the early days of the organization, we had a very good system, but it became limited. That system was strictly a grade and yield system. It became limited, as I said, through the growth of the organization and its marketing. In the last year or so, there's been a question arise quite often. That one question is, what is the National Farmers doing? I normally answer that question with another question. That question is, about what? And then it comes, you know, about getting a price for our cattle. Well, most people that ask that question are very sincere and would like to know what the organization has been doing. And a lot of the members today, the reason they can't quite see that or see what the organization is doing is because they're too close to the situation. And I want to use an example. Devon Woodland, our president, last night mentioned that the average farm age is 64 years old. So let's just assume that we're all grandparents. And as I look over the crowd, I see that there's some people that could be grandparents, and I know there's some people that can't be, which is good. I like to see the youth in these meetings. But for this purpose, I'd like all you to pretend that you're grandparents. And let's say that your grandchildren live in the West Coast, and you haven't seen your grandchildren in a year or so. One of the first reactions that grandma or grandma will say when the children come and visit is, my, how the children have grown. How many of you grandparents see that? Quite a few, right? Well, now, the parents don't think that their children have grown that much. And the children, they don't think they've grown that much. The reason for this is that the parent sees that child every day. And the children are growing with their schoolmates and friends. And I'd like to compare that, use that as an example, to some of our cattle feeders in the organization today. They're like the parent of that child that sees that daily growth, but just can't quite see that annual growth. I'd like to make another comparison. I'd like to compare myself to a member. Let's say there's a member in a county, and actually I'm sure most counties have that type of individual. The individual that comes to a county meeting, let's say one out of every four, he sells some of his cattle through the organization and some he sells on his own. He talks to his neighbors and friends about the organization and he hears what's going on, but doesn't quite hear all the happenings of the organization. That individual was a lot like myself. I felt that I was keeping well informed in my absence. After all, I lived in Corning those 7 or 8 years, and I talked almost daily to someone from the home office. Walt and I probably talked for a good year and a half before I came back to work for the organization. I felt that I could sit in that chair I occupied close to 5 years back in 1969 to 1972 very easily. I thought I could come back and have no problems. Well, I was wrong. I was very wrong. I came back to an organization with computers. Computers that could give you information that you never had before. Computers that gave you information the very next day that used to take 2 and 3 weeks to get. Marketing analysis that you never had. And a department that could sell your cattle, you as producers, just any way you wanted to. There's no way that you can market cattle that the organization doesn't have. Some areas we can't fulfill all that. But there is no organization and no packing house that can market cattle in more ways than the organization. I'd like to step back for about 13 years or so and see what it was all about when the organization first got into the business of collective bargaining for your cattle. See how they operated in the industry. Back in 1968, the organization's main goal was a cost of production plus a reasonable profit through collective bargaining. That goal is still the main goal of the organization. That goal will be that goal until it's achieved. So finally, in 1968, the first supply agreement was signed with the packer. That supply agreement was nothing other than the local market. It never called for 25 cents over anything or anybody, strictly the local market. So why did the organization sign that contract and have it ratified by its members? The main reason and the only reason is that in the history of the American cattle feeder, no organization of any kind signed any kind of agreement, supply agreement, with any packer. How many people here today can remember that giant step the organization took for its cattle feeders? I see a show of hands. Quite a few of you. But how soon was that contract accepted as strictly standard operational procedure? And how soon our people forgot how hard that contract was to come by? I'm afraid that a great many of us have forgotten some of the important things in the organization in its early days. As the volume of cattle grew through the organization, so did the contracts. As the contracts grew, so did the benefits of the organization, so did the ways that they marketed. The National Farmers Organization started pricing their contracts off the national provisioner, commonly called the yellow sheet. And I personally can remember going into zone meetings and explaining this contract. And one of the main questions that would come up was, what's the yellow sheet? Well, as most of you are aware, the yellow sheet has been in print for the packing house use for a good many years. I would say well over 25 to 30 years. But it took a little farm organization with a lot of guts to educate the American cattle feeder the packer used in buying his live cattle and selling his carcass beef. The yellow sheet was the Bible that the packers used to market their finished product. Then somewhere around 1970 or 71, the organization started using a little word called offal. I'm going to spell that because I used to spell it quite often. And that same question would arise. What is it? Well, it's a packing house terminology that the national farmers started using for its cattle feeders. They were the first ones. The simple definition for offal is it's the edible and inedible byproduct left over after the packer puts his carcass in the cooler. It used to be kind of pin money to the packer before the organization started using it in their supply contracts. I want to explain that a little further. I'm going to use some figures that are obsolete. They're back. I tried to use memory on this and tried to keep it as original as possible. Our offal value today is somewhere around the 57-cent figure. Can you all see that? You want to dim that a little bit? Yeah, can you see that, those figures there? All right. I'm going to use a $20 figure. What we did, this offal figure is a USDA figure that they put together, and it's a weekly market. So what we did is we went to the packer and said, we want some part of this offal. We said that we will use a base. And if that base goes up, we want part of it. If the base goes down, we can understand that you can't pay as much for your cattle in relationship to the sheet. Now I'm going to use a yellow sheet figure of 50 cents. Because at that time, that's approximately what they were being priced at. Now when we first started using the yellow sheet, we were $2 under it on a cold weight basis. But for this particular purpose, I'm going to use a dollar over the national provisioner. Our base then would have been $51 per hundred on our choice yield grade 3 steers. Now let's just say next week the off-all value goes up $2. And for this purpose, I'm going to use, for every dollar increase, I'm going to use a 25-cent premium on it. We have a $50 steer price, a base price of a dollar over the sheet. That would give us a 50 cent premium on our offal, which would give us $51.50. You want to turn those lights back on, please? Using these figures, you can see where if that offal went higher, we got it. There was another idea in the using the offal figure. We knew that the higher the market went, the more the pack, if in the offal value, the more the packer could pay in relationship to the provisioner. But we would go in cases, sign an agreement with the packing house. Let's just use an example of going in and signing a contract for a dollar over the sheet. And then, as the off-all value went up, he could afford to pay more. Well, we could go into an area that would be 50 cents over the sheet, sign a contract for 75 cents over, and in no time that would be the going rate for all the cattle. Well, what this did was kept us in the market as the off-all value went. We changed our bases quite often. We had a stop gap in them where it, if it went down, we'd renegotiate. If it went down at a certain level, we'd renegotiate it if it went up the same way. So this kind of kept us in the market. It did another thing, and as I said before, that the packer used to use this as kind of pin money. If it wasn't all his profit, it sure took up quite a bit of his kill cost. Now, if the packer was bid a particular day on, say, 10 loads of choice steers, if he was bid, say, 50 cents, what the sheet was, and he had all the off-all value in it, he could afford to sell it at 50 cents and still have a profit. But if we took out some of that off-all value profit, then he had to hold out a little bit longer on that bid of 50 cents for his choice steers. And thus it would bring up the entire yellow sheet, and that's how our cattle were based off of. The off-all value is a USDA figure that's very hard to manipulate, just about impossible. So it was a good neutral barometer for us to use. I can remember personally in the mid-60s working in the southern part of Minnesota in the country for St. Cloud Meatpacking and kind of having my own way about my market. And I always give Earhart Finkston credit for this particular instance. For quite some time, I worked in the Marshall, Minnesota area. And one Monday morning, I came back, and I couldn't have my own way about things. They just said, well, you know, the National Farmers signed a contract with Packer X, and you're either going to have to pay that or you're not going to get them. And I look back on that quite often. And in the 60s, there were quite a few cattle feeders in the country that were riding the shirt tails of the organization. How many are doing the same thing in the 80s? Quite a few. But that's collective bargaining. It brings up the market to everyone. That first contract that the organization signed made it possible for the organization to sign better contracts in the future. And one of the first contracts that I have in mind was nothing other than the local market. And on the side of that contract where it had the National Farmers Organization representative, it had Norbert Heinricher's name on it. It's a name known in this organization today. He's still with the accounting. On the side where it had the packing house representative's name on it, it had Andrew J. Neutzling. Not my name, but my father's. I still have that contract in my desk drawer, and I looked at it just about a week or so ago. And it was about a page and a half contract with all the loopholes in the world in it. I can remember the organization fulfilling that contract for its first 90-day period. And I can remember the organization coming back for more benefits on the next contract. Now, how many of you people think today that St. Cloud Packing would have signed a second contract, much less a contract with more benefits to it, if the organization wouldn't have fulfilled its agreement? None of you, I'm sure, think that they would have, because I know they wouldn't have. I know my father very well. He spent 3/4 of his life in the packing house industry. And he was no easier nor any harder than any other packer in the business at that time. That very first and most important contract, people, was nothing other than collective bargaining for its members. I have another transparency to show you. This transparency I'm going back to 1968 again and using a $50 choice steer market with a 650-pound carcass, and I'm using a contract of a dollar under the sheet instead of the two that we started with. That would have given us 49 cents on a cold weight basis, or $318.50 on a total 650-pound carcass. In 1980, we have contracts on our grain yield programs of $3 over the sheet. So that would give us 53 cents on a hot weight basis. Forget about the hot weight to cold weight basis. Assume that the market never changed. That particular carcass would give the membership a net gain of $26 per head. Want to turn the light on, please? $26 a head if the market hadn't changed at all, just in collective bargaining. As the years went by, the national farmers started using marketing along with their collective bargaining. And at this time, I'd like to ask Duane Wynn to come up and give you some examples of how this all got started. Now, on behalf of Duane, I would like to say this, that last night at 11:30, I asked him to do this. Typical trick, isn't it, Duane? We had an individual prepared to come to the convention, and Sunday morning he called and he had to put his wife in the hospital. So Duane is going to fill in for us. And I appreciate it very much, Duane.
Thank you, Andy. Just one thing, when you get a late notice, well, you don't have much time to worry about it. The other thing is, as long as you're telling what's happened, what the truth is, you don't have to worry about getting fouled up. So that's what you're going to hear today. What Andy asked me to do was start off as I was a plant rep. Come on through as to basically the duties of the plant rep and on out into the field rep as we're using today and some of the reasons why. Time does move on. When I was talking with Andy last night after he asked me, he come back as to, well, when did I start as a plant rep? I don't know, it didn't seem too long ago. It was in either 74 or 75. Don't pin me any closer. But it was sometime there. But basically what my duties were as a plant rep, what a plant rep's duties are, is the first thing is I would get into the plant in the morning, I would go out through the pens of the cattle that I had in. I would observe the cattle. If they were mixed loads of mixed owners, check for back tags, etc., that they were on. If you had load lot cattle, take the observation of them and I'd eyeball grade them. Find out how good I was the next day. Then we'd go on through, as we went through the kill line, I would follow the cattle through. Watch the hot weights and see the cattle graded in the cooler. Also, see that the returns were put out properly, that the cattle were priced according to whatever the contractual arrangement was, and that the returns got back to the collection points. And then usually within the daily duties also, there would be a phone call every once in a while that maybe I had one that didn't grade as good as what I thought you did, because you know we all got top cattle. We don't have any goods or standards or never have a stag, and that hard bone shouldn't have been in there. This was one opportunity that I did have as I followed the cattle through and watched them graded. And I would explain to the people what took place and why it was. Again, at this time, this work was all being done over the telephone. One other thing that I always encouraged was that you come in and watch your cattle graded. We've got an educational program, as Andy had started with here, and it continues on, and we're still within an educational program. But come in and watch the cattle graded, see what they look like after they get the hide off and they're ribbed. And maybe that most beautiful load of cattle you ever fed may be the most undesirable when it comes to marketing. But I couldn't tell you that on the phone. I could, but I wouldn't be very popular. But you could see for yourself, and then we would compare the rest of the cattle in the cooler. And you would learn. And I could see the members' progress within their feeding. They could change their feeding habits, and they could keep with the times. And ladies and gentlemen, it's one thing that is very necessary today. If you don't keep up with the times and the changes, it's going to run off and leave you. This is what we've been doing. We've given you that opportunity. Now, one of the things that we could see as we were in the plants and working basically over the telephone, cattle would be scheduled in to us. I had very little problem with the cattle not being delivered if they were scheduled. My biggest problem that I would come up with, and most other of the rest of the plant reps, was this, that you would have a potload, 40 head of cattle, weighing 1,000 pounds, all choice. And when you went out into the pens the next morning to find them, you couldn't find them. Not that they weren't delivered, but there just wasn't 1,000-pound choice cattle there. Maybe they were 800 or 8 1/4. Not that it was done intentionally at all. Maybe them cattle would have worked much better at a different plant. So this come within the progress that we were making within the department at this time, that we had to do was get the right cattle to the right plant in order to benefit our membership the most. Now, how do we do that, and who do we use to do it? It just seemed to make sense that the people that you would turn to put into the country would be the people that had the experience at the plant. They had the rapport with the plant people. They also had the rapport with the membership. And they had the experience of seeing the cattle come in live and seeing them in the cooler. So this is a group of people that we drew upon. And we moved them into the country, again, to give our membership better service and do a better job for you. I could do a much better job by visiting with you eyeball to eyeball right out there in the cattle yard than what I could over the telephone 75 miles away. And this is where we led. Then by coming into a better description of the cattle, it led us into some other options within our marketing program that we're using today. Andy was talking the straight grade and yield. And that's all we had when I started back there in the plant in 1974. So much over the sheet, day of kill. And that's it. No options. But as we were coming with better descriptions of cattle, had the more up-to-date means of markets and etc., as Andy was talking about, in order to pass this back to the membership, it was made available to us, put in the country. And then we could come with the option in many areas of the grade and yield, still had the grade and yield. We could come with the flat beef or the guaranteed price. It kind of gives you the best of the best. You know, they say you can't have it both ways. Basically, this is what we've got. If it looks like into the next week that you're going to have a market flatten out or go down, the best thing to do is tie that price in. Especially if you can get a packer that's pushing for some cattle yet. This is the option that you have today. If it looks like you're going to have some strength within the market within the next week, then we'll probably say, let's kill G and Y priced on the sheet. You've got it again. I see Mel Modernock in here. I've handled a considerable amount of cattle for him. Is that the way it works, Mel?
You hit it most of the time.
Hit it most of the time. It's not me that hits it. It's Andy and Homer. Because after I observe the cattle, getting a step ahead of myself here, the first thing that I'm going to ask you when I come in is basically when you put the cattle in, what they weighed. And then the next thing, what are you feeding? How'd you handle them? I'll walk to the self-feeders of the bunk and take a look for myself. Then we discuss the cattle. After we discuss the cattle, probably my next question to you is this. What do you have to have for the cattle? What I'm doing with that question is a couple things. I want to know if you're in the market or if you're shooting for the moon. Because if you're shooting for the moon, I'm wasting my time. Let's be realistic. We agree upon a price that you would be satisfied with. When that price is agreed upon, I make a phone call into the negotiators, either Homer or Andy. I describe the cattle to them, tell them the price I need, and I will do as good or better. And they're my cattle to sell. We'll tell you when to deliver. If I cannot do what I said, then I'll be back in touch with you. We will discuss it again. I'll tell you the best I got, and we decide which route we're going. And that's the way it works. Now, basically, I come with the people that have been on the program for quite some time and it's been working well with them. I don't believe it's too often we discuss price, is it, Mel? Pardon? It's not too often we discuss price, is it?
No, I usually tell them to sell them when you think it's right.
Sell them when you think it's right. And he does. I want to tell you something. Mel wasn't always like that either. No, all I'm saying by this, and I'm not picking on you, Mel, but we all have to grow. We've got to have confidence. And what I'm saying is that our program is working well enough with our representatives within the country today that we're gaining that confidence. Not only from the producer's standpoint, but from the packer's standpoint. And this is the direction that your cattle program is moving. It's been very successful. We do have in our plants yet where we have got mixed loads, coal cows, loads like this, it is very necessary that we have a plant rep in. We've got our plant reps there. In some of the other plants, we do not have, but basically anyone that has been in them plants has still got the opportunity to spot check that plant anytime they want. I can walk into any of the plants that I'm dealing with. I will take the producer in to watch his cattle graded at this time yet. If he requests, just set it up with your representative in the country. And this can be done. I don't know of any other marketing group today that can offer you all these options and still give you a collective bargaining system with a guaranteed check. Never forget that. We're only beginning. We've got a good start. We're still going to move on, and we're going to move on further. Another thing that you'll get through this program is you get a kill sheet. You know what them cattle are doing. You sell to the buyer, you take his word. I've had people tell me that are marketing practically all choice cattle today. Before I started on your program, I never marketed a choice head of cattle in all my life. But they're on the same feeding system they always been. You know what you're marketing. Just good common sense. One of the best ways, also in order to move this program on, and to help your rep out here in the country, is talk to your neighbor about the program. Tell him what it is. We've had people tell us that you people have got the best kept secret in the world. Sometimes I think that we're afraid to tell somebody else what we got because we do not want them to be a part of it. But let's tell them about it. Not only tell them about it, tell your rep about it. Take him in and introduce him. You do the groundwork, we'll do the rest. And that spreads us to so many more people. Yes, I can go out and go up and down the road and make the contacts cold. It doesn't bother me, but I'm a stranger. It's going to take me a few contacts in there before I can gain any confidence with that man whatsoever. If you know him, he's got confidence in you. That's 75% of the battle. And the program will continue to build. The volume will continue to grow. And this comes along at the situation we've got today. Andy, I'm going to turn it back to you at this time.
There's a few things I'd like to point out on Dwayne's comments. And sometimes it bothers me to hear some of the mistakes we've made, because it wasn't necessary. It could have been taken care of. That's all we needed is the volume in the past years. By that, I'd like to say, in the early days, someone misrepresented their cattle. Or I shouldn't say misrepresent, didn't understand what that individual had in his feed yard. But after you think about it, for a while, you can't expect a 10-year-old child to do college work, can you? And it is through nothing but education. Mal made an interesting comment last night. I had the opportunity to have a sandwich with him. And he was talking to someone about his marketing. And Mal said, you know, I'm never going to always be on top of the market. But throughout the year, my cattle are marketed better than anyone else's.